And we just talked about the essence of this conversation, which is, to put it short, it's a walk on the wild side. Theater and horror, sense of politics, let's say. Okay, so first you.
So my name is Iulia Popovici. I'm a performing arts critic and curator, and recently
you have a job?
I have a job. I'm actually employed in this culture magazine called Culture Observer. And I'm also, I'm working a lot with legislation lately. And I've been the co-curator of the Comedy March Festival in Cluj, which is also in Romania, since 2011 until this year when we decided to close the festival. And I think that's why, that's why they had the idea to
speak in the topics.
Yes, one of the topics.
Hello, my name is Grzegorz Reske. Very briefly, someone asked how to introduce me. I'm an ex-curator. I'm an art historian by education, never practiced. I'm a culture manager, practiced for some years. In the last 5 years, my focus was on the festivals and curatorial practice. For 5 years, I was co-curator of the festival called Tendencies, in which I ran with my partner Vanta Kai, which after 5 editions, the founders and the director of the festival decided to put us aside because of too high political risk we are bringing with our practice. And in the last 3 years, simultaneously, I was also curating a festival called Kalisz-Pieter Meetings, which is the oldest Polish festival dedicated to repertory theaters. And the reason why it's also ex-job is that it's not only me, but the directors of the theater were replaced because bringing two politically confusing topics to the relatively small town of Kalisz.
And if you talk about ex, I'm an ex-university teacher. Right now, we are together with Tomasz and two more people. We are editing a critical website called Revisor, which basically belongs to us, so nobody can replace us. So I'm completely on the other side of the theater profession, so I'm a theater critic. It might be very interesting to be an ex-curator. Okay. Now we are talking about the changes of the situation of theater as a profession and as an art in the three countries. And it's going to be a contest of where is the worst. Okay, Iulia, you make
join us.
You make your bet first.
I don't have any intention in competing with you, because we have so much freedom of speech that we could just drown in it. We just don't have any money, and nobody cares about it.
We do, I say what I want.
The thing is that now there's this discourse in Romania, well, on Facebook in Romania, because that's where the public Facebook, about Romania turning into Hungary or Poland, or Turkey, I say. But usually it's with Hungary and Poland. Well, and that's not possible. First, because Romania never had what Hungary and Poland had. So it's not like we are falling from that height to just feel it. But let's see why we...
Maybe you're climbing upwards I mean, because you're not falling down?
The main problem, so we are in the context where you, Hungary and Poland have political issues and issues connected to censorship, political censorship. We have something very simple, basic, called economic censorship, but not because somebody wants to censor us, but because nobody, because culture is not important, not even as a political tool. Mm-hmm. And so let me, and I just feel that everybody's like, when they hear about, well, there's no money, because the discourse is, there's no money anywhere, we don't have money either. So let me tell you the short story why we decided to just kick ourselves out from our own festival. So Don Dimash had, was now at its 10th edition. And we realized that we are making a 7-day long international festival and published a book, a catalog, catalog on the Dimash Festival, bilingual. We are inviting international guests. And we are doing everything, this thing, with 45,000 euro out of 8 grants.
Where are these grants from?
So the system in Romania is designed of public banking is designed for beginners and most small projects. So there's this maximum amount that you can get in public money, which is not decided by the law. It's so everybody is deciding on their own money. So the city hall is all the national endowment for the arts. But the threshold is 17,000 euro. You cannot make a festival with 17,000 euro.
17.
So everybody's, the new system is to have this big project, which was our festival, and cut it in different pieces.
Four or five?
Yes.
Four.
Yes. Yeah. And you apply for different sources of financing with pieces of the festival. Mm-hmm. And because, I don't know if you heard, but Romania is the most corrupt country in the EU, so we are in the middle of a
definitely not
empire corruption fight.
No, no
which
way.
Which means, well, that's the discourse. So we are like fighting corruption. Fighting corruption means that for every cent that is supposed to be spent from public money in culture project or in everything, in small things, mm-hmm. you need to bring 10 pesos. And every time there's a form of control, there's a new set of papers that everybody has to fill in order to get the reimbursement of the money. Well, imagine this. For 45, multiplied by 8, for just 45,000 euros. And imagine that even with the low fees that we are paying in Romania, because but we cannot afford to employ anyone, so everybody is just paid for the project. So even with the low fees in our country, it is basically impossible to just keep the people in the team, because they have to leave.
And they have to survive.
And we start the festival because we realized that we were lying to everybody. We are lying to ourselves, saying that we can do what we wanted to do, but actually we couldn't. Because we couldn't grow up from where we were. We couldn't offer the community, the artistic community, what we wanted. We were lying to the public cultural grant system, saying that it's okay. We can do these things with
and
much
there's more. No politics in it. It's just the pure financial threat.
Let's put it this way. We had I had a very interesting conversation with a Czech colleague, mm-hmm. and because we had this discussion, we realized that we are living in countries with different culture foundations. Romania is a country built where literature is the most important cultural thing.
At least there is something that is important.
For literature, you don't have to spend money. Because, you know, people
yeah,
are...
Everybody is writing at home, yeah.
And it's an individual kind of occupation.
Yeah.
And the editorial system was the first one to be entirely privatized.
Mm-hmm.
So we have this very ambiguous, as a country, very ambiguous relationship with performing arts. Because they were always sort of a superstructure. And even during the communist times, we didn't have a counter-system movement in the theater. And everything that was supposed to, you know, foster the anti-communism feeling was in the literature. And basically, this is the, you know, we are so logocentric that anything that is not written doesn't matter. And we are so stupid as a nation, and our politicians are so idiotic that they don't consider culture as something to be manipulated. It is not that important.
Okay, let's check if the politicians are, this ideally important.
No. Then initial notes. This sofa is very comfortable. I have a very, as every jobless person, I have a very hard working week behind me. So if I will silence for a second, it's probably that I'm looking for the English word. If for 3 seconds that I might fall asleep, just hit me there. Yes, I would like to zoom out on the Polish situation a bit, because sometimes I end up in this inside theater discussions, but this is not what interests me the most. We always discuss our work with Magda as political one in terms that it have to be in a strong relation to the society, so about the politicians. I'm coming from the country which flourish. Economically it flourish. You can open the newspaper, also the newspapers which are edited by the opposition, let's say.
Oh, you still have newspapers like that. Great.
Kind of, yes. In the last 2 years, we celebrated not long time ago the 2 years of the government. The minimal wage was more than doubled. The unemployment rate dropped from after the political change. It was always around 20%, according to the
microeconomists.
According to the economists, it's not possible to run the country with 20% unemployment. It's undoable. Now it's about the 5%. We have one of the lowest. Pardon?
You still believe what is published in the newspaper?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
I mean, you can also find it in the internet. It's like it's hard to search. So we have all the security, the social security rise a lot. There is a kind of contract with the society. I can like the exchange rate with the most of the currencies also drop. I mean the Polish currency go up. So everything is going. Everything is going. There is this contract on the table. We will give you as much as the social protection as possible. And this is something which none of the politicians, no matter of the constellation of the government since 1989 was really focused on, no matter they call themselves social democrats, post-communists, neoliberals, worker unions, no one take care about. What the society has to deliver against it is we will not in education, in the art, in the everyday life, we will just go along with the government. We will not curse our history. We will only present the good picture of the country. This is really with all the differences, of course. And I can't say that we are directly on the Weimar Republic track, but as I described it in the last 2 minutes, this is social nationalist. And here the relation with the with the politics, the political life, and the culture, art and culture comes, because instead of the Romanian situation, for some reason, those politicians at power now believes that art and culture is a great tool to create the new citizens of the future. So,
it's kind of, it became a kind of political means.
Yeah, it is.
The culture as such. At least it is important for them, right?
Yes, and in this, on this level, they of course have to remove everyone who has an influence in a cultural structure on the topics, on the content which is delivered to the audience, and replace them with the people who will follow their agenda.
It's something that is familiar already, yeah. As for Hungary, okay, I don't know if Hungary is the economy and everything is flourishing. Our numbers are not this good. So if you read the printed media, you'll find numbers like this. We're getting hell of a lot of money from the EU for 2 more years, I think. The great part of this money doesn't go into the Hungarian economy, but to certain persons, you know, the political scenario. As for the culture, we don't have a ministry of culture. We have a ministry of human resources, something, right? Which is a gigantic ministry combining culture, education, healthcare, social, whatever. What else?
Sport,
yeah, which is very important. We are the leading nation in building stadiums, football stadiums. So, a village, you know, with 1,000 inhabitants, and a stadium for 3,000, you know, whatever. Okay, so the culture on the one hand, for the present political power is not important at all. On the other hand, it is very important, so they create the institutional background in order to be able to change the canon, the cultural canon, or the artistic canon, which is very, very, very difficult. I mean, it's very easy in practice, you know, they just move people. Actually, almost all of the theaters outside of Budapest got a new leadership. They changed completely. The audience either left the theater or they are satisfied with, you know, what they are getting from the theater, which is this commercial leadership. But after, this is a process since 2007, so even before, almost 10 years already. So by now it seems as they are running out of clients, which is very important because they really didn't care if the client is suitable for the position or not. So if they are kind of running out of clients, it means that nobody on their side wants to be a director in the theater. So now we have open, we are beginning to have open tenders for theater director position. We have plenty of money in culture, a lot, so they organized the Hungarian Hungarian Academy of Arts as a, you know, as a counterpart or as a parallel for the Hungarian Academy of Science, which is a 170 years old institution, which is a place, a nest for the clientele, you know, for the really reliable people getting kind of their own money. Still, this process is not very successful, not in the literature, not in the theater, because the people somehow just didn't want to like or didn't want to prefer as an art what is given to them. So, on the one hand, I'm optimistic. On the other hand, because the situation almost couldn't be worse. So we are getting to an end of the process. As for the festivals too, you know, one of the international festivals is owned by the director of the National Theatre, can have a lot of money, but he doesn't have, say, taste or knowledge of what's going on. Okay, so what are the perspectives for those who are really involved in the, you know, in that part of the theater that all of us prefer, for all of the things that is the favorite one? What are the perspectives? What about the independent theaters? What about the next generation? What about the education, I mean artistic education? Iulia.
Well, it is that we have in Romania tenders for directors or directors since 2008, but it doesn't mean that our theater managers don't die in function, because the law actually allows for it. Actually, this means that theater managers are transporting, let's say. So they are going with the power, no matter who is in power. And this is why, actually the public theater is less dynamic, but in the same time less dangerous for any kind of political power. Since they are so disconnected, the public sector and the independent sector, and also because there's so little money involved in the party in the independent sector, there have been a lot of diversity social political engagement in the independent on the independent scene. But the problem is that it's also reached a certain threshold, because the generation who actually invented or built the independent scene is now reaching the 40s, and they have different needs of development and developing their initiatives than the emerging artists. And actually, the system in Romania is not ready to deal with, because it wasn't prepared for that. They never, like the National Endowment for the Arts, which is the most important institution, you know, orienting culture, this whole, the financing system, decides what kind of art you do.
Is there a door or a passage from the independent theater to the proper established professional one?
Very little. There's one director, and I think you all know her, theater director, who is now manager of a public theater, which is but she's already in a fight with the local authorities because she changed the logo of the theater.
Not surprised. Yes.
And otherwise, you know, the public system is very willing to build on the reputation of the artist on the independent scene, but not changing the production scheme. So they are taking artists and somehow reach sort of a compromise with the public system, not changing anything fundamentally, but allowing them to bring some of their practices from the independent scene. But they are not integrated. So there's no, there hasn't been any message from the independent scene, this logical thing, from the independent scene to the public scene. Even Chanina, she only worked in two public theaters in Sibiu, and when she worked in Bucharest, she worked in a co-production. So there was a co-production between a public theater and her own independent company. Because, you know, it's like public theater wants the international glamour of some of these independent artists, but they don't want what brought them to the glamour. This is the paradox.
Okay.
And actually, you know, it's they all, everybody's feeling this pressure of not being able to grow anymore and to develop. Of course, those the younger ones who are coming from behind, they don't have enough place because the others are still there, and also they cannot, they don't have the same conditions in order to invent their own language the way the previous generation did. And then, because we are only, you know, economically challenged, not politically challenged, I'm sorry, now I'm cynical, we will never be able to bring in Romania the kind of international you know, guests you have in here, because we are not, you know,
you don't get the money, yeah.
No, we would have the money, but we are not interested.
Yeah, you are not interesting enough. Yeah.
No, because...
Okay, you have to wait, Ayla.
Yes, you have to be, you know,
it's on the way. It's on the way.
Actually, draw this kind of attention. We are not only poor, we are not political leaders.
Yeah,
you know?
It's a little like
and a little stupid.
Yes. Okay, how is it important?
No, but just wait a moment. It's a moment of being so exotic that they will eagerly come. Okay, I have to now draw a bit wider background. We have around 110 repertory theaters with the permanent ensemble in the majority of them, all around the country. Besides of two of them, all others are run by the local authorities, so they are not dependent on the Ministry of Culture.
So you don't have these emblematic national institutions like the opera, like the national theater?
There are. These are this small amount of the national opera, the national theater in Warsaw, the Star Theater.
And all the others are local.
But most of them are run by opera, which means they are also much more involved in a game of powers.
Of
the cities they are involved in. In this promotion of the local politicians when they come to the next election. Out of this 110, probably 100, is delivered what we can call safe, middle-class, boring entertainment to fulfill the, and also to fulfill the law which was changed after 1989, so the public theaters, the managers of public theaters who decided upon them, they promised to make the income, which means they have to be very focused on on the one hand renting the space, and we know that in the European, in the Stadttheater system, the theater do not make the debts if they don't perform. At the moment that the theaters start delivering artworks, they are also making the loss in a bookkeeping.
Yeah, it's a bookkeeping manner.
Yeah. So what the program brings is the staging of the school literature, that it's easy to make a profit of it, because the moment you establish a good network with the local schools, you bring the children
every day.
Or you deliver the entertainment for the local side. Yes, exactly. Then what we discuss here is 10% of the, let's call it artistic theater. This is what interests us in the media most, and this is why we are showing really, because we are discussing about non-commercial stuff. On this level, we have only repertory system. It's changed 20 years ago. The moment when those artistic theaters start to be taking over, the first case was Jarzyna taking over Teatr Zmaitości in Berlin and Warszawa. And from that moment on, the doors to the repertory huge institution focused on the artistic world were wide open for the young generation of the artists. So they had no chance to build this independence of avant-garde, however we want to call it, movement, which was very very active in Poland in the 70s.
Theater is kind of part of the professional.
Yes, it's very fancy from the point of view of the managers and the management of the theaters to bring someone who is on the second, third grade of the theater school already to do the first production.
Uh-huh.
But of course, so these people already at the very first moment of the career, they are meeting this completely unfunctional old style, huge Stadttheater structure with doing quite interesting works with the young actors who are also focused to experiment, to deliver something which will be also interesting and engaging the young audience, but they do it in a structures where we have 30 people involved. Being involved also in the international situation of the world, I hear from also from some of you here in this room that, oh yes, this was very interesting small production for 4 hours, but actually when the festival approached the theater, it appeared that it had 30 people traveling, so we did not book it properly. And of course also, besides of the economical impact and the economical influence, the avant-garde or independent movement is in a way when it is on the market, when it is on the entire picture, is because it is independent, is much more difficult to be manipulated and to be animated by the state. But when everything goes to the official institutions, which are in a direct link, no matter with the local authorities or the state authorities, it's very easy to destroy, to control.
Yes.
At the worst scenario, to destroy.
And do they?
Yes. The two big theaters delivering this artistic content, the artistic program. One is Tat Polsk in Wrocław. Another is National Theatre, one of the National Theatres started in Krakow. The directors were replaced. And the ensemble, and those of you who are coming from the countries with the tradition of the repertory ensemble-based theatre knows that it takes years to build the actors' ensemble. but to destroy it, it takes one season. The people, the Wrocław team do not exist. The artists from Krakow started because this is this season situation. It started in September. Especially younger actors, the actors who can try to find the track also in commercial sector, they are leaving the theaters. So, but this is an ongoing process. We don't know how it. The only thing we already know, we are IHS, the people focus on the artistic theater, no matter linked to the repertory institutions or not. We see that there's no infrastructure to continue outside of the institutions which are in direct influence from the administration.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the next question is, and in the meantime, I'd like to open up the discussion. So anybody who wants to ask anything, to add anything, just feel free, okay? So don't wait until, you know, I see that you want to say something, you should be able to say. But the next question is, which is a more sensitive topic, how can you see, if you can see at all, the social problems, the political problems, the conflicts, the political, actual political views, can you see here somehow on stage of these certain theaters? And to add to this, to destroy or to demolish a theater and a company and a repertoire is so quick and easy, at least here, that you can do it, you know, in no time, in one season or max is two, and the theater is like it never existed. But to rebuild it, to reconstruct something, takes probably much longer time. So, and we lost a lot of theaters. How can you see the real state or profile of your country if you should see the theater performances, or can you see it at all? Okay, please begin.
Oh, good. Yes, I believe that this is what those artistic theaters in a huge part was doing, and this is why they were so unpopular among the politicians that they followed this. Recently I heard, and I think this was actually Apachin who was quoting Fassbinder saying, describing what is the difference between the art and the culture, the culture is everything, the culture is what we are pressing, the culture is how we see the culture, is what we do. The art is the temperature sticking the mass of society. Mm-hmm. And this is what this artistic theater was doing, actually. So, exactly, it's... and then, I'm a bit schizophrenical, because I came to blame myself and the milieu I'm the part of is that somehow on the call it practicing of life, we a bit move aside from the society, which now costs us
private the sphere of private life, or
yes,
in which direction it is.
Too many money in the field, too much. This is that coming back to what I said at the beginning, that in a way doing the artistic theater puts a lot of the huge part of the of the art society on the shelf of, I would say, upper class, relatively upper class in the Polish context. And then there is a lot of problems we see now when the very social orientated issues being again putting it in the context of the state theaters, of the repertory theaters. You come with as a young maker, theater maker with this huge drive. You will change the world. Describe what doesn't work in a society, which in a 99.9% means you come from the quite leftist.
Critical to the present establishment. Yeah.
But at the same time, entering this, as I said, very non-changed the old structures, you very quickly start repeating very horizontal. The vertical structures. So I have also putting it on the level of the symbolic gender issues. You are the direct dress who is coming to make a difference, and you stage your work on the stage, but you do it internally in the team, and in the institution. You do it not as a direct dress, but as a director. But there are lots of topics we are now discussing internally, I would say, like what harm it did, and how we now have to position, because if we left the society, even describe it in a critical way, but we left it on the daily basis, aside now, why we should go to the society and says, we will keep this important role of the artists in society, but we have to help us because the state will not help us. And I think this is the big difference between the Poland and Hungary, at least how I see it from outside. Mm-hmm. That the recognition of the role of the artistic speech from a certain part of the society in Hungary was much higher and helped some artists in this transition than it happens now in Poland.
And listen, if I went to Poland now, could you suggest performances of which I could visualize, what's going on in the country, what are the important issues?
And now, of course, we will end up with the Curse by Oliver Village.
Okay, very Village is not a Polish director.
Yes, but it's also somehow symbolic that we had to import Croatian to give us an entire picture of the society. This is a performance which openly says about the, to put it nicely, discussable position of the church as an institution in the society, the issue of pedophilia in the church, and in a very positive picture that says society at large was. Every time the Polish Pope was speaking to the Polish nation, was clapping, never listening what the guy wanted to deliver. Fortunately for most of you, this is the performance which is, you have a much more chance to see outside of Poland than inside of Poland, because outside the repertory of the theater which produces the piece, none of the venues, none of the festivals in Poland will ever program it.
But
they tried in dialogue.
Yeah, that's why
they lost the finances. Yeah. They tried.
Yeah,
it's not. It's it's not true. It was once performed in Poland outside Warsaw. It was in Kosów, in a theater which is completely focused on the entertainment. It's a music theater. And they did it, there was a summer festival, they did it during the summer festival only because the general artistic director was completing his last contract and preparing himself to retire.
Yeah, so it was
actually, yeah, yeah.
What's the name of the director? Oliver
Filić. You know, the Croatian.
He's Croatian.
He's scandalous guy, you know, all of you. Yeah, or national, middle, Eastern Middle European hero. Thank you. And how about, would you suggest?
I have to tell, because this was also like, we also with Marta went through this moment of self-censorship in a way. I can give you the described point. There are some texts also which we published around this topic, and Marta is in her research also working a lot about this topic. This was the case of the last edition of Fantasia also. We proposed this performance into the program. We've been told by the management of the institution, which the festival is part of, that they will not. This was before the dialogue, and this was before the Marta festival. Because just the additional thing, Oliver Filić was also the curator, invited the associate curator of Marta festival, which also lost the money from the Ministry of Culture. Promised and contracted money because the minister said that he will not give the public money to something which Filić is involved. It was not only about that particular performance, but his persona non grata in the country as such. So we proposed the performance. We heard no from the reason given was that the management will not leave. They will not. That they are aware that it might lead to the economical problem of the institutions in the future, and this ban from access to the ministry money. But as the curators, we agreed on that. We said yes, we'll do the program, knowing that we are leaving the festival. We said okay. We made an offer and the promise to other artists that we are bringing them. So in a way, we censor ourselves.
Listen, it's quite difficult, I think, throughout this region, the directors of real good Hungarian theater when they don't open their mouth when they should, or when they don't back certain movements in theater. They usually say that they are responsible for the whole theater, for the whole company, and they cannot risk the they cannot risk what they are doing on stage, and their real job is to put good performances on stage, and it's true that they're doing that. So you are, as a critic for instance, you are in a pretty ambiguous situation whether you know what to say about it. Because on the one hand it's self-censorship, of course, on the other hand it's a simple lie. I mean, on their behalf. But anyway, it would be quite a suicidal act to speak up. Okay?
But you know, that's what I was saying. You know, now everybody will flock to Poland. No such story, because when we showed, we presented our violence, your violence in Cluj by the same Oliver Filić, there was total peace, nobody protested. It was
you you have to import some social,
No, there are two things. The one, I think that it's important to invite Oliver to do some, like ask him to do something in the Romanian context. I think it's those who know his works. He works as this kind of fixture in the every time when he entered the institution or the ensemble, trying to find the structures of the conflict, etc. I think with Blondfar, he jumped even on a higher level, because also having the artistic success with this production as a promotion of Polish theater, this is one of the best. Technically, like as a piece of art, it's one of the best performances I saw in last decade. And everyone in this artistic theater media in Poland, festival makers, festival curators, artists, etc., journalists, had to position themselves in relation to that production. And the second, to jump on a more soft level is, you know, in a moment it's easy, as long as it doesn't have the direct relation to the church. So my violence, like, what's the title? Yeah. It doesn't, it's yet, it might go. It's yeah. when it's
level of Golgotha PG?
Well, Golgotha, that was the problem, Golgotha, but yeah, it's another story, it's yeah.
You can, could I see good picture of what's going on in Romanian society through performances?
Well, yes.
Do you suggest an assignment?
Yes, first if you go to the we had a piece with an Ukrainian director called Andrei Zsolnák, who is famous for his violence and his very violent performances, but actually not in the same and he actually, he had a physical confrontation with an actress in Cluj about the nature of the team of the Hungarian State Theater called the police. But everything was presented like, well, it's a great piece of art, the show is absolutely amazing, let's not talk about the human person when we have such a wonderful piece of art. So this says a lot about actually what the Romanian society is. The need to campaign. I have a very long series of interviews with what it means to be a female director in Romania. Well, actually, since 2006, more women graduate from directing than men. But out of 100 performances in the repertory of the National Theatre of Bucharest, none is directed by a woman.
Uh-huh.
More than half.
So what are they doing?
They are either abandoning very early, or and most of them are working in the independent scene. Which actually shows you how the other side of the Romanian society looks uh-huh. like. Because the independent scene has more women directors, more actresses in some other roles than the poor, beautiful young lady.
Mm-hmm.
It considers itself very socially involved and it tackles very hard topics.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, the maximum size of a hall on independent scene.
50?
No, 100. If you squeeze them,
yeah.
And actually, I'm so proudly talking about the independent sector, but it only means basically Bucharest and Cluj. And from time to time, to other cities, and that's the end of it.
Yeah.
So, if you go to the public theater, you discover, you know, one side of Romania that looks very much like the 19th century. And actually, since the average age of public theater managers in Romania is 50, so you have...
Oh, this, it's young.
Well, yes, because China is 40, and the
Spanish is
45, so they somehow work on lowering the average, because the
think we are tending to 60 or more. 60 or more.
Out when they were around 70, 75 because they were stealing money.
Because this anti-corruption thing is in many words.
After 10 years, ends up coming to the theater also. So you can be for 10 years, not more, because they
I was really envious when you put your prime minister in jail.
No, he was never in jail.
No, never, but maybe, you know, he was close to it. Okay.
Actually, when he stopped, you know how anti-corruption works in Romania? After he stopped being prime minister, all the accusations were dropped.
You know, I wouldn't mind that.
And you said the magical word. It's about the Netherlands.
Only the parliament.
The
public
theater is not willing to accept any kind of... Because the perception of our society is that everything is so Kafkaesque.
Yeah.
That if you step one, if you walk one step of the 19th century, you risk everything.
So not only your position, but the position of the theater as well, right?
Well, you know, we are talking, the biggest theaters are run by managers that have a certain age and who have been running those theaters for decades. Yeah. The manager of the Hungarian State Theater is...
27.
And the manager of the National Theatre in Bucharest, well, he only has 12 years, but he's 75. Uh-huh. So they are very attached to a certain model, certain models of production. And they are doing their best to preserve something that is related to their own identity. It is very difficult. There are a lot of technological and societal changes that are very difficult to grasp. When you have a certain life experience and you have a certain age. For instance, it is very, the independent sector has self-affirmed leftist ideas. Well, to talk about the left to a 75-year person in Romania,
it's not the same as
it's a generational thing.
Well, it's rather about liberalism, probably, so not only left, but...
Yeah, and it's the thing that this unpredictability and this idea that nothing, you cannot argue anything, so everything is so Kafkaesque, you can't be hit by anything anytime you want. So there's pretty much no risk. For instance, we don't make entered the public theater in Romania 10 years after it entered in the independent scene, and imagine that the independent scene has very low resources, so for them to do video making was something very almost outrageous.
Okay. We need 2-3 hours more here to talk about this, but you know, it's time to go somewhere, I think. One last round. About, you know, if anybody wants to ask anything, but, and I'd like to hear a few, you know, who is the winner of this walk on the right side? Which country?
I'm working in France. I am from the region, it's in my I'm gonna ask you something which is probably an exercise that is sort of mind-bending for those of us coming from this part of the world, and I'm gonna ask you to be positive, because you're painting a rather big picture. So I wanted to ask you, because I'm convinced that there are, in everything that you describe, there are pockets of resistance. They might not be in the theater, or might not even be in the cultural sector, I don't know. But where do you see these pockets of resistance in your respective countries today? Where does your poem lie?
Okay,
the least tragical, I have to answer first.
Or who is the most...
But it's a question of, actually, it's a question of the endurance. For those of the artists on the independent scene in Romania that are that actually build a discourse and artistic practice, it is a question of how long they can resist under the existing conditions. So, and this is something that is to be tested now. And for me, that's where the hope is, because if what happens with this generation actually has a consequence for the next one, because if you don't offer to the next generation examples of success, they won't follow the same path. Because if they know that that path
leads nowhere,
they won't go on that.
Yeah.
So okay. it's this question.
It's quite a strange hope, but it's hope.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Because if they did it until now, there's this hope that they will manage to resist, and then there's going to be a hope for the longer period. But I won't necessarily bet on that.
Okay, Oren, where is your hope? Where is the where are the places of precious stuff?
I was in panic, when Julia was speaking, I was panicking, trying to find out something, and I failed, but I can only, maybe not because I'm so tired after that, I didn't. No, I don't, maybe also because we are so recent with all what he does, it's only 2 years. We are still in a mourning mood and still do not so much seeing the light in this tuna. I could say, although again from the wider perspective, if there's a hope, this hope comes from the kind of how to call it the community movements. That the people start organizing themselves at a very basic level. I don't know how much it might be transferred into the artistic practices. It can, probably, and artists will have to find a way. But as I said at the very beginning, this is the kind of very easy, very basic contract. We will provide the but then I will end the questions.
No. Okay.
We will provide you quite comfortable way of life, society at large, but you have to follow our
tricks. To put it shortly, shut up.
Yes.
And in Hungary, oh no. As far as I'm concerned, my hopes are pretty controversial. One part is that I think we've got pretty close to the bottom from where there is only way upwards. And on the other hand, the independent theater and the next generation. So that's what I you simply cannot hear them, even if they don't have money, if they don't have place, if they don't have anything, they go somewhere, wherever, and they make it there. So you cannot hear it. But the next generation, that's what I'm, even if it means my personal, that's it. So, thank you both. I don't know who is the winner, but you discuss it. And as about the theater situation in different countries, you can have more talks within yourself. Thank you. Thanks for it.